want to have a laugh about it. And it was a really wonderful thing to be a part of.
Have you known anyone in your life who's had a terminal illness?
Other than, I suppose, at the elderly end of things, and then a few uncles and aunts that got taken, I guess you could say earlier, because they were, you know, in their 60s, but no one that was very close to me, no one. And I think that was very exposing in hearing those stories.
Yeah.
It wasn't just the four individuals that I had to consider. In fact, they were the easy part. In the retelling or in the joke writing around their stories, I really had to consider their loved ones that were in the room. Because it's one thing to make a joke about Matt, for instance, who's the youngest participant in that episode, who's only 23. And he's got a great sense of humour. He has an inoperable brain tumour. And we had a great laugh together. And I knew the jokes I'd written he would laugh at. It was his parents. It's his bloody parents. That's somebody's baby.
Absolutely.
You know, and that's a big thing to try and get someone to laugh about. You know,
it's interesting for him hearing that he had great sense of humour. Obviously, I lost Greg, my late husband, to brain cancer, and I think watching someone go through something like that, sometimes all you have is hope and humour. And he was one of the funniest people I've ever met, and his ability to find humour in the darkest of places. You know, he used to call his tumour the dud tumour. and I met a woman recently called Donna who has brain cancer, and she calls her tumour Terry the Bastard. and I just think in both those situations, and I know this is common for lots of people, for them it's about not being defined by the brain cancer and giving a name, a comical name. So when people, you know, used to text Greg and say, how's the dud tumour going? It was an easier conversation perhaps than how's your brain cancer going? And there was lots of moments, lots of funny moments. He'd be sitting there having blood taken to find results of something, and you'd have a trainee nurse that couldn't find a vein to save himself, and he'd come out of what would otherwise be quite a scary scenario and find the funny anecdote from that scenario. And I think sometimes that's because there's nothing else you can do.
If you did
the opposite, you would cry. So sometimes you have to laugh.
Well, like Nicole, who there was actually a bit in the stand-up where in the live performance where I was directing something at her, and I quite nearly got choked up. And I'm like, that's not the right role. I'm not meant to cry on stage. But, yeah, this is a young mum that got diagnosed with bowel cancer, stage 4 bowel cancer, when a baby's 8 months old. When you hear that first part of the story, you're just like, well, there's nothing funny in this at all. And then talking with her and getting to know her and finding funny in her experience was really joyful for me. And one of those was the fact that she just wouldn't stop going to the gym. She went to the gym just after she finished one of her many operations, and she just went, she goes, I went a bit early because I busted a staple. But just like, if you could see the picture of Nicole and just and have that come out of her mouth, just, yeah, I went a bit early, busted a staple. Just an excellent attitude to life.
Just also a great turn of phrase.
Isn't it?
You haven't gone hard till you've busted a staple.
That's right. Well, because as I said, I wouldn't go to the gym.
Yeah.
It is interesting, friends and family, though, watching that, because I think there were moments where I found Greg's ability to laugh at it hard, and other times when it was also relieving for me that he had the ability to laugh. And I wonder how often the patient in that scenario is being like that to help the people that love them so dearly who are watching them in pain. Like, maybe it's a way of help saving us from the pain.
I think so, definitely. And